here with Joe and the Fisio to take a closer look at that game. And, you know, Rocket is 4-0. They did win this game, but Gambit wasn't looking all too bad.
So I'm actually quite impressed with how Gambit have managed to play both days. I mean, they're a completely new team, I guess we can say, really, with four subs, everyone out of solo queue. And they've actually done really well. We've seen a few moments that actually look like they're a well-practiced team together.
Right, and it was also clear in this game, we talked about it yesterday, how Rocket's play style now is slow and steady. Take your time, build some strong late game comp here and just play safe. Don't take any chances. This game was the perfect example. I mean, they gave every single dragon to Gambit, which is very weird, but they're just waiting for this late game point, get Baron and try and finish the game. So it's not the most exciting thing ever. It works for Rocket. The thing about Gambit and the thing you talked about is how well they're actually playing, because there's all these solo queue players put together very, very fast. I mean, the replay we have actually really shows the synergy. So if we just pull it up on the screen, we can actually see it's a team by around 17 minutes here at the Dragon. And of course, Dragon was all about Gambit in this game here. And if you just roll the clip, we need to notice how Gambit moves as a team here. And again, this is solo queue players together. Notice Heba here, his ulti is going to be so perfect. He used it to zone the rest of Rocket away. The only overpower is actually there doing damage. Jengus jumps in, but again, the rest of the team are gone. Capo Shard, he delayed his teleport for such a long time that once the Stranglethorn was down, he teleports in, joins the fight. And he is weird for me, because Rocket, as their professional team and a team who knows each other so well in the synergy, they're the ones splitting up and going different directions. And Gambit, the solo queue team, are the ones staying together and chasing and actually winning the fight, getting another dragon here and getting ahead in gold.
Yeah, absolutely. And Vander did mention it. I didn't think we played all that good today, but still 4-0 for Rocket, so very good for them. And now we're going to check in with you guys at home, because earlier we asked you to send us your tweets and let us know which position in the European LCS do you think has the deepest talent pool and why. And here are some of the responses. The first one is from @Nando51297. Mid has the deepest talent pool, from amazing mechanics in Frog and Xpeke and Kerp to the Farm King Selfie.
It's always been the thing about Europe. Everyone always said we had great mid laners. I mean, also just looking a few seasons back when Alex was there, I was dominating all the time. Of course, Xpeke and Frog has been there for such a long time. We had Bjergsen, we had Nuke Dog, if you look back to the Lemondog time and the NIP time in the season 3 points. So always have very good mid laners. Now, of course, we have the same Kerp. He can carry games by himself. And as Selfie, he can actually do the same thing if he gets enough farm.
The second one is from Adberg Matt. The deepest talent pool is the ADC position in EU. There are veterans, Candy Panda and Genja, but also talents like Reckless and Mr. Ralph.
Yeah, and I think it's really great to see we've had some fresh AD carry talent coming through. Mr. Ralph, obviously Reckless, we can kind of count him since he only really turned old enough last year to come into, or this year really, to come into the LCS. But then you've got the likes of Woolite, who impressed everyone and has since moved into the Copenhagen Wolves. So AD carry, definitely a lot of fresh talent out there, and I'd expect more to be coming through too.
Absolutely. The last one is from @Peppo, I'm Batman. Jungle, Diamond, Shook, and Svenskeren are all top-level junglers, and with talent such as Ku, EU can only improve. A lot of talent in the pipeline.
I agree. Again, solo queue, we have so many good junglers, and we see even here for Gambit, solo queue players coming in, showing the skill. We have good, very good junglers in solo queue. You talk about yourself also, Svenskeren coming back here, really showing his form. Diamond had a few issues with the rest of Gambit, but still he's picking it up, he's coming back to shape, and we know how good Diamond is once he actually hits his top level, and I definitely hope to see him hit this top level again and show the rest of the junglers who's the boss.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, thank you guys for sending those to us, and remember to keep hitting us up on Twitter @LLEsports along with the #LCS. And now let's head back over to Demon and Quickshot to get into our next game.
Thank you very much, Shox. Our next match features SK Gaming and the Super Hot Crew. The last time these teams met, SK Gaming fought hard to keep Super Hot Crew down, and with some great spears from Jezzes on Nidalee and a strong disengage from Enrated on Zyra, they were able to maintain control. Yesterday, though, it was a different story for SK Gaming. They got absolutely bullied by Alliance.
Yeah, SK Gaming just got outplayed by Alliance. They fell behind after their lane swap didn't work out, and they couldn't find any positive plays to help them regain control in the game. They were just outmatched in every single aspect yesterday, and they will need to adjust their gameplay significantly if they want to challenge the Super Hot Crew, who secured a win yesterday and should be having a bit of a confidence boost.
Well, in that win against the Wolves yesterday, Super Hot Crew secured a win with their substitute, Yarrow. The game itself was actually very messy, with both teams getting called out multiple times. The overall winner, though, had to be the Super Hot Crew. Top laner, Mimer, who first picked that Kayle and absolutely destroyed them.
Yeah, 13-2-5, and as a team, the Super Hot Crew managed to get ahead. They made some positive plays, thanks to Mima securing a multitude of kills and getting ahead early on. But I do have to call Selfie out again for his Twisted Fate. While it did secure the win, if you contrast it to other TFs, he picked a few wrong cards, and it takes him a long time to get those Destiny Ultimates to work. We haven't seen him impacting side lanes as effectively as other TFs have, like Kerp, like Peke, to come, you know, who come off the top of my head.
Well, earlier the Super Hot Crew's Impaler promised a surprise for SK Gaming in front of his home crowd, while SK's Freddy is ready for the Pride Stalker, who might make an appearance in the top lane.
SK are playing really well right now, and I think they deserve to be placed that high up in the table. They played really well last split as well, and a lot of it is attributed to their teamwork. When we see they're doing so well, we want to beat them, we want to take them down a notch.
I would never count them out, and I would never say that they're getting worse or going in a slump.
So Belko just needs to adapt, like see what mistakes they've made, what caused them to lose their games, and if they're able to do that, then they should be fine and winning matches again.
We've got a few like cheesy comps up our sleeve ready, and we keep on hinting towards them, but right now we're not really pulling them out. I think we'll probably pull out a kind of cheesy comp at London if all goes well. So yeah, hopefully the crowd will have something to look forward to.
If they pull out anything, it's going to be a Rengar top, but I don't think that's going to work. I think Freddy can manage to lane against Rengar.
I've got Rengar in the back of my mind because I'm not sure if I want to play against it or not, but probably prepare something against it if we do.
See whether they do pull out something special. Rengar, maybe? Kale? Maybe it's just Kale. They probably
I never believe them. I never believe pros when they talk about something special.
It's like one of those champions that everybody plays.
I'm hoping they prove me wrong. We haven't seen Mima on Rengar. I'd like to see it.
Yeah.
Our entire show.
We've talked about it for so long.
We'll have to see.
He gets a chance to play it. Let's see if he can do it. Has he got the balls? Let's see. Check out the starting lineups. Over on the blue side, it is SK Gaming. That means Freddy 122, the Englishman in the top lane, who... He believes everybody thinks he's French, by the way. Svenskeren is the jungler, Jez is in that mid lane, Candy Panda is the AD carry, and Enrated on support.
Yeah, and for the red side, it is the Super Hot Crew with Mima in the top lane, Impaler in the jungle. That's what I wanted to hear. Selfie in the mid lane with Mr. Rawls and Yarrow as your support.
He is English, by the way, Yarrow.
I'm aware of that.
Who else that? Before the champions are chosen by the players, let's take a look at the voting from LOL Esports. According to the numbers, 74% of you have gone for SK Gaming in this one. And this is actually a close game, though. So, you know, Super Hot Crew are still chasing hard.
I completely agree. SK are just sitting higher up the table. I think they have performed to a higher level of play than the Super Hot Crew, but you can't deny the fact that Super Hot Crew have the skill, the ability, and the teamwork to actually overcome SK, especially if SK are mentally destroyed from yesterday's loss.
Yeah.
Because Alliance completely picked them apart. Freddy was saying he's prepared a counter for Rengar. We'll have to see what he decides to play, whether that works out. Jez's yesterday had
Renekton.
little to no impact. And it's interesting you say that because Alliance banned Renekton yesterday. 100% win ratio for Freddy on that champion. They also banned Orianna, which is not a champion that we see banned very frequently, if ever, in recent months.
So, if Selfie is to step up, what do we think? What's he going to go with here? Can he get that Yasuo maybe? You know, there's a lot of bans going to be targeted potentially towards Impaler, maybe
Yasuo,
even towards that top lane.
Yasuo is one of the most banned champions against Super Hot Crew because of Selfie and how much he likes to play it. It was the champion that allowed them to beat Alliance
6-0, in week 1 or week 2. Like crazy.
At the end of the day, 8-2-8. But yeah, 6-0-6 before giving up his first kill. And expecting it to be banned, I almost wonder if Twisted Fate may not be a thing, or may be a thing for Selfie, because he has been trending towards it. It's 3 games played this split already. It's something that he's picking up. It works, especially if Mr. Rawls gets his hands on Twitch.
Well, we'll see how it works out, ladies and gentlemen. Picks and bans getting underway. Instant Yasuo.
Not surprised by that.
Not going to get that one through.
Kassadin ban has to be a consideration for Super Hot Crew.
Yep.
For junglers, you've obviously got all of the primary junglers, but I do want to say that we've been seeing Impaler. He played Jarvan yesterday, if memory serves. Had a difficult time in the early stages of the game, but later on, once Mima hit that power level, he then had a lot more positive cataclysms. And slow ban phase from both of these teams, really calculating what they want to remove off the table.
Well, there is the KO. We saw Mima going huge on that one yesterday. No surprise it has to be considered and taken away. We've just seen Overpower doing the exact same in the last match.
So both of these teams are Twitch teams. They, Candy Panda and Mr. Rawls are big fans. If it's not banned, it is also a consideration for an early pick. We know that Yarrow played Nami yesterday and had some very, very good tidal waves. It was our, you know, LCS big play all the way at the top of the show. So there's a lot going on, nothing thrown towards junglers yet. So if Lee Sin and Lisa are available, we'll see what Impaler decides to run. He's the one that's been talking about these special champions and these special things, you know. It could be a Nocturne in the jungle. It could be something as simple as that, which Impaler has also played in the past.
Well, Twisted Fate being taken away. A lot of focus on those top laners as well.
Nidalee's open.
Final
well.
One will be Lee Sin. Renekton open, Nidalee open. What will their first choice be? Will it be Twitch maybe for Candy Panda? Will
Twitch,
it be Kog'Maw?
Twitch, Nidalee, Elise. With banning Yasuo, it opens you up to locking in one of those champions. I'm very surprised by Morgana. I'm very, very surprised considering the power of some of the other champions that are available. Morgana is just very reactive, very defensive. And while you don't reveal anything, it now allows Super Hot Crew to run whatever they consider the most impactful, the most powerful. But they could save the support pick. They don't need to lock it into later and go for a jungler, go for an Evelynn, go for an Elise, go for J4 if they wanted to.
But this is often what SK actually prefer to do. They often prefer to counter pick into what their opposition do. Even when they're on the blue side, they'll generally sacrifice. We'll see whether Super Hot Crew go towards that AD carry. Braum, of course, is available. Will get locked in alongside Lucian for Mr. Alice.
Very, very strong combination. Concussive Blows passive plus Lucian's Light Slinger passive?
Double tap, yeah.
Double tap, two shots, is just going to get the stun. We're not revealing anything. We're not seeing anything. Junglers are still up. Top lane is still available. Shyvana's there. Trundle's there. Irelia's there. Hell, Aatrox is there. Freddy's played Aatrox in the past. Mima has played Dr. Mundo in the past. Everything is available, and it just depends on what these teams want to run, because this is the safest start you can go for. There's very little that you can be worried about when you see this Lucian, Braum, Morgana, because you know what you're in for.
Well, we haven't seen Caitlyn for a long time, that's for sure. Caitlyn Panda has been locked in. Evelynn, of course, also for Svensgeren.
So Genji's the only one that's really been running Caitlyn in recent weeks. With a Morgana and with a Caitlyn, I wonder if SK want to maybe look for a tower swap to try and avoid the 2v1. Caitlyn can do okay against Lucian thanks to her range, and Morgana can avoid at least one of the stuns that Braum can put down. But what Caitlyn and Morgana do offer with the long range binding, the wave clear that they have from the Piltover Peacemaker and the Tormented Soil is very fast tower pushing. The only thing that doesn't necessarily work with a lane swap tower push is an Evelynn. She's not the strongest, of course, being a melee champion means if you go for you know, fast tower pushing strategy, it is quite difficult to make that work. And for the time being, just very calculated decisions. We still don't know what SK are looking for.
Yeah, SK playing a dangerous game though. Not going for Kassadin, letting it through. Super Hot Crew not fancying it themselves. Has taken a couple of hits over the last few patches, of course. Lulu locked in though, alongside Jarvan for Impaler. Despite Elise being available, goes towards that Jarvan who we saw being very successful yesterday.
Yeah, very successful in the later stages of the game. It's been a while since we've seen Impaler on Jarvan, and I think his laning phase definitely could do with some work. But with the Lulu locked in, we're not 100% sure if that's top lane or mid lane yet. You have the opportunity to swap that one around, which is great. And also the wave clear from Lulu is very good. You've got relatively good wave clear from Lucian if they need to get themselves into a tower defense situation. But we're not seeing anything exciting. Super Hot Crew have been full of nonsense. It's not locked in yet.
Kassadin is though. Aatrox alongside him for Freddy. And we've seen Jezzes on Kassadin before. It was one of the first games of the season, I believe. And he managed to pull that one out. It's a great success.
Yeah, it is something that...
Oh! There okay. we go!
So, okay. So, what this means, that's either going to be a Jarvan top lane jungle Nocturne or jungle Jarvan mid lane Nocturne.
It's a mid lane Nocturne.
Against the Kassadin, that is going to be very, very good. We need to just see how this works out. Because you can spell shield those force pulses, get the attack speed, and any melee champion does very well against Kassadin in the early stages of the game. You can punish very hard. And what I love about this combination is the gank power that you have with a Jarvan flag and drag into the Paranoia from Nocturne. The only thing is, Caitlyn, Kassadin, and Aatrox can all get out of Cataclysm ultimates. So Impaler needs to be very on the ball when it comes to targeting the right people, because there's a number of champions that can escape from that terrain that gets built up.
So there's theory behind this. We've seen it in Korea as well, and this is where the theories come from. It's a big, big gamble, and they said they got something special. They actually do this time.
Get ahead or lose. That is how mid lane Nocturne works. If their first few ganks and he doesn't shut down Jezzes quickly enough, Jezzes and Kassadin should outscale him.
No, with the lineups, are you still back in SK Gaming? Head over to Twitter and tell us who has the advantage now by tweeting hashtag SKWin or hashtag SuperHotCrewWin to LOL Esports, and we'll be checking those results shortly. So, Kassadin Nocturne, this mid lane, this is almost certainly the one to watch.
Yes, definitely. There's no doubt about it. We need to keep our eyes on how aggressive Selfie plays the lane. He's going to be pushing very heavily with both his Duskbringer and his Umbra Blades passive. So there's going to be AoE going down. What I love about Nocturne picks as well is the power that it will give you in a split pushing comp. He's going to be able to affect the side lanes and pull aggro towards him and then still respond with paranoia. The question is, how far ahead can he get in the early stages?
Well, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Game two of the LCS underway. SK Gaming currently in second position. 7 wins, 4 losses up against the SuperHotCrew in third position with 6 wins and 5 losses. Can they tie up that second place alongside SK Gaming, who, of course, are playing blue versus red? Svenskeren, is he going to sneak in? We saw an invade from Gambit. Didn't quite work out. Rockout were ready for it. Let's see if they do the same.
I really feel like SuperHotCrew need to have very good vision to deal with Svenskeren's Evelynn. If Evelynn is able to camp the middle lane and help control and shut down Selfie, the gambit of running this Nocturne is going to be a little worrying. You see, Mr. Rawls has already almost challenged Candy Panda. Oh, advantage SK. Candy Panda gets an auto attack down. And it looks like it's going to be head-to-head lanes. So that means Sven, maybe they're backing. Yeah, if SuperHawk could go for the lane swap, they can almost force Svenskeren's hands. But again, we need to just see how the lanes eventually end up.
Glad to see Yeru running the dragon. Bromskin as well, my favorite one. So, Mime in the top. Could be standard lanes, as you mentioned, but no, it's a switch.
Yeah.
Will be Mr. Ralas and Yeru heading up there. They're going to go for that 2v1. Will they go with the buddy system? Selfie's got a little twitch on going in the mid lane.
So this will be interesting to see how Selfie handles himself on Nocturne. You know, he's been playing many, many more champions since re-qualifying in the promotion tournament for summer. He pulled out Fizz, he pulled out Twisted Fate, we've seen his Orianna, he got his hands on Yasuo eventually. So he can play the melee AD champions, and SuperHotCrew, they've grouped up, they're going for an invade. They want to try and put pressure on Svenskeren. This is very important to help Selfie in that middle lane.
Forces Freddy away, they are going to get in towards this blue buff. Mime running defensive duties to keep him well away from that one. Svenskeren is going to try and rotate straight towards it. SuperHotCrew now coming out on top after the Nocturne pickup, despite a Kassadin being picked up by SK Gaming. Freddy and Svenskeren, they're going to react quickly. They want to go towards that blue buff. They're going to start off with the red, though. And you can see, meanwhile, we do have Impaler and alongside him, Mimer going towards that red.
Yeah, and there's the pushing power that Selfie will have on Nocturne. Against Kassadin, especially in the early stages, he should be able to shove him in row. And what I like about that is it should also allow Selfie to either get involved in counter jungling or in defending his jungle camps. I don't think Impaler and Mimer can get to that blue buff quickly enough, and even if they could, Enraged has been pulled up for support. So they're trading jungle map halves. SK are in control of the bottom right-hand corner, and SuperHotCrew in control of the top left-hand corner.
Yeah, it's going to be quite clear for them. And they had vision of it, so SuperHotCrew in full knowledge of what is going on across the map right now. Jezzes, keep an eye on which way they level this one, because it's going to be something of interest. It's not a normal matchup, that's for sure, that we've seen in any LCS in any country. But look at SK, they're reacting themselves. We've got the bottom half of the map. We are going Dragon.
SuperHotCrew are looking to take the tower. So they've grouped up with their 4 members in the top lane, and with that Demacian standard for Jarvan, it's also going to give attack speed to the rest of the champions involved. So Dragon for tower, it actually should be a gold advantage to SuperHotCrew, as a super early Dragon is not worth all that much, whereas the tower is taking a very long time to go down. It almost looks like the focus isn't 100% on shredding it. They're denying a lot of CS from Freddy. Yeah, he's backed off.
Yeah, they are going to let the tower go down. That's going to wipe out as many minions as possible. They're going to have to finish it, though. If they don't want Freddy to defend this one, which he will, they chose to hold on there.
Yeah, it really didn't look like everyone was giving their all to secure the objective. So SK with a very early advantage. You know, we've been seeing those 3-4 minute dragons from teams mostly running Elise in the jungle, actually. But today, it's just been a matter of lane swap. If you put your duo lane top, you lose dragon. It's that simple. And actually, in the next patch, Dragon Gold goes up to help ensure that if you decide to make that trade, you're actually it's actually a little more worthwhile for the team that gets the dragon early on.
So Super Hot Crew switch back around, and it's standard lanes once again. Candy Panda and Rated up against Mr. Riles and Yarrow in this bottom lane. Selfie has got a level advantage over Jezzer so far. Gets that dust bringer down on him. Gets a couple of basic attacks down. Actually cancelled the animation on the last one there, and I think he hit the minion instead of Jezzer's, which didn't take him quite so low as I think he'd like. Of course, with that cleave bonus he gets on that, he'll be wiping those minions out very quickly. 40 CS to 28 as well in that mid lane. Big advantage. Going back early. Going to get himself his first item.
Yeah, and of course, the passive from Nocturne is also going to allow himself to sustain through some of Kassadin's poke. So Jezzer's hasn't really been troubled by this Nocturne. Selfie's played fairly passively. He's pushed the lane a little, but one minion wave has been lost at 5 minutes, which is not a big deal when you consider if you'd run something like an Orianna, you could have punished that Kassadin significantly harder. But Selfie is getting closer to that paranoia. He's gone for 3 long swords. So he's gone all in for damage, looking for the bonus AD. So his Umbra Blades and his Duskbringer have just got that higher impact. And you can see Impaler already moving to this middle lane. Fortune stood right on top of a ward, so Jezzer's is completely aware of it.
Yeah, just slightly too early. That time's out. Doesn't matter. Knows he's still there. Not going to worry about it. Svenskeren was waiting on guard duty just off the side of the race. Means Impaler. He's kind of wasting his time here. Instead, he's actually going to go for a bit of invade, but you can see there's not really any jungle minions there either to take away. Could go across towards the white.
Oh,
maybe go towards the top. Meanwhile, Unbreakable forced out there, stopping Candy Panda. Trying to get the stun down on towards him. Mr. Ryle's not really following up.
It's actually nice to see Yarrow react to that. Whenever you see these Brahms being played, one of the nicest initiation combos is to use the stand behind to jump to a minion, then look for either a auto attack or to get that Winter's Bite onto a target, because you can jump to the minion wave as quickly as possible. SK are pushing bottom, but Selfie, the range on that paranoia at rank 1 is not particularly massive. He needed to get a little closer to that bottom lane to make it work. And unfortunately backed away as he seen that Jezzer's was pushing up through the middle.
Good trade straight back on towards him, as you mentioned, those 3 long swords. Selfie reacting as well, went straight back. Started out with that cloth armor, I believe. And he's keeping up relatively well on the minions, despite the strange setup that he's got. Svenskeren looking towards, coming across towards this blue buff. Let's see if Super Hot Crew want to react to this one. Impaler did have a look towards it earlier, but I don't think he's in any position to take it, and Jezzer's will get the blue.
Now, we also need to keep an eye on how quick Selfie's reaction times are. That Shroud of Darkness, the spell shield on Nocturne's W, is only active for 1.5 seconds. So he really needs to make sure he pulls that up at exactly the right time to block whatever damage. And they've caught Candy a little.
Well, they're way too slow, meanwhile, in the jungle. But you can see down this bottom, as you mentioned, they caught Candy out there. Super Hot Crew went looking towards that blue. They were the ones that had the timer. They were the ones that took it out. Yet they were not there on time.
No, unfortunately not. Super Hot Crew are just content to continue laning. CS pretty even across the board, with the exception of Impaler falling a little behind. You could argue because of his attempted gank mid lane and a little bit of floundered time elsewhere around the map. But a very slow start, and this interesting Nocturne pick hasn't shown why it's picked yet.
Yeah, not yet. Pink Ward found out, Svenskeren will clear that one. Let's talk about this top lane. We haven't had a chance to talk about Freddy and Mima too much. It is an Aatrox versus Lulu. SK Gaming actually on the invader. They did take the blue before, remember, and Impaler's coming around, but he's too late to this one. SK gonna take it.
Yeah, that's going down very, very quickly. I think Impaler had sensed something was up. No vision on the bottom lane, so he didn't look to invade. Waited for the support of Selfie. And, you know, you mentioned Mima and Freddy. They're quietly going about their business. With the knockup of Freddy being his primary initiation, and while he's got the slow from those Blades of Torment as well, I don't really think there's a lot of kill threat from either Freddy to Mima or vice versa, especially because Mima's only got a Chalice of Harmony. So until jungle intervention gets involved, I think these two might just be living on their little CS island and looking to make the best of the experience and the gold that they can farm up.
Self is going to back himself off. Jezzers has done the same. He's going towards the Rod of Ages early on. Brutalizer now completed along with Vampiric Scepter for Selfie. Mimer, as you mentioned, is clearing out the wave and breakable big dragon. That's not going to be blocked out by Yero because he used it far too early. Dark Binding also catching on and the Piltover catching on towards him. So the Unbreakable effectively do nothing before all that damage come in.
That's very important for SK because they can ensure the engage power of Yero is just completely reduced. Now that Yero has access to his Glacial Fissure at level 6, the potential to go all in and look for kills is there. The slow is massive at 60%, and if Lucian gets a full culling down, even at this stage of the game, it's very scary. But look at Yero, his HP down, and he's got another binding.
Yero's in trouble, they're gonna surely dive on towards this one. He's gonna try and sneak away, but look at the back, you can see Svenskeren ready and waiting to come in. That next wave, he's gonna be on Yero.
He's definitely going to. Glacial Fissure is available. Summoner Heal was used in the previous engage. So if Exhaust is not timed effectively from Yero, he's going to be giving up potential first blood.
Selfie's looking to come in, Impaler's already en route. Sven's going off the side there, that wave coming in, and Mr. Raleigh's nose in, the culling in there, Dark Binding doesn't land, blocks out, Glacial Fissure goes in, Sven's going, flashes away, stun on the tower, Sven's going, going down, what a fantastic turnaround by the Super Hot Crew, and now Jez is on Selfie, going in towards there, blocks out, uses the Paranoid, does not have the damage though, Jez is with the Ignite, just about runs out, and it's a one for one.
Damage is just not there from Selfie, and that interesting pick from Super Hot Crew gives up their first death. A very, very good play from Yero. Manages to hold Svenskeren in place, stun him up under the tower thanks to the concussive blows, and it's Super Hot Crew that grab the first blood. They should also get a lot of damage on this bottom lane tower. One thing that we also didn't catch on camera, but both Mimer and Freddy went toe-to-toe. They burned their ultimates and nobody went down. So it did look like an aggressive play from Freddy, who used his teleport to come back to lane. Super Hot Crew, they got the top. They've got Freddy!
Oh, he's going to try and go for the double tap. Yero tried to get in towards him. Katakus comes in. He actually catches Svenskeren, not the one he wanted. Candy Panda, who he was looking for. But they take the tower and keep on pushing. Suddenly, this game turned aggressive.
That is a super decisive play from Impaler. There was no hesitation. Flag, drag, flash, slam, dunk. And if Candy Panda had not had his flash available, he would have gone down. Mr. Rawls is trying to make use of the double buffs that he'd secured. And with him backing away now, he's going to spend 2,800 gold. So he's got a massive amount of money that he's got to spend thanks to the kills, thanks to the tower. The Super Hot Crew, while they've given up a kill, they are still looking like in a pretty good position.
Well, oftentimes throughout the spring split, Mr. Olives was the man that Super Hot Crew had to call on, and right now, no surprises, he is in the lead right now, but Selfie's in trouble. He's gonna flash away, does get away just about. That Shroud of Darkness, the stopping that bounce up from Freddy.
Yeah, no other spell shields, and Super Hot Crew, their mid lane Nocturne. We'll see. We'll see how it works out. SK got the timing on Dragon. They secure the first one very, very early on and very easily grab further objectives.
Top two, of course, was traded. So Mimer finally taking that one down. It was on a slither of health for a long period of time, but that means it's 2-0 in turrets. Mr. Rales now has to be a little cautious. You can see SK were trying to come around the side there. Impaler is a little bit behind at the moment.
So 100 CS for Jezzers at 12 minutes, a completed Rod of Ages, a kill under his name, two dragons. This is a Kassadin that is next to permaband everywhere. And Jezzers has already got victories on this champion. He needs to be focused, he needs to be shut down.
Mexican waves going through the audience right now. Crowd keeping themselves entertained. The game's actually pretty lively, and Blue Buff is once again up. And this time around, Super Hot Crew were looking to get closer. They have got the ward coverage down there. Jezzers is yet to move across, though. Meanwhile, look at the river. We can see Mr. Rales and Yero. They're making their way up, clearing out the pink wards as they move towards that mid lane.
So Paranoia is available, as is Cataclysm for Super Hot Crew. If they want to contest for this blue buff, they do have the tools available to them. Svenskeren's going to try dropping. Here comes Impaler.
Oh, he tried to flag and drag strike. Didn't get in there. Instead, they're going to go towards Svenskeren. Cataclysm, as you said, is available. There's the flash. He hasn't got enough to follow through. Yero, meanwhile, blocking out the damage in that mid lane. Saves himself away from Jezzers. He gets blocked off on the edge of the hole. Fissure goes down, Jezzers caught out, stun goes in there, they have to back away, coming into the side, look at this, you can see Impaler's in there, slides on through, Cataclysm on Candy Panda, 90 caliber nets away, very nicely played, and still no one goes down, Freddy looking around the side, Jezzers waiting in the wings, very low on health. both these teams slowly disengage.
Very, very dramatic turn of events. The mid tower is close to going down if Super Hot Crew can stick around. But because they've got no ultimates and their primary initiators are a little low, they've backed away from the tower. What they also ensured was the blue buff was taken by Svenskeren, not by Jezzes. That will also delay Jezzes' farming and his power for the next few minutes. So overall, Super Hog could come out not too bad in that situation. They got the exhaust from Enrated, they got the flash from Svenskeren in exchange for actually just the paranoia in that situation. They burned a few ultimates, but additional summoner spells being burned for SK. So Super Hog crew, in the bigger picture, come out ahead from that total trade.
Himself is backing off, calling himself Bilgewater and Brutalizer last time around. Let's see what he picks up. It's going to be Blade of Rune King completed, maybe. We do see, of course, the beginnings of Azonia's coming out for Jezz. It's almost certainly an important defensive mechanism with that arm guard up against Selfie in the mid lane, despite the fact, well, lanes are kind of already gone. 15 minutes in, this game is opening right up.
It really is. And Selfie's starting to pull ahead in terms of CS, slowly growing further. I really want to see if Selfie decides to play the split push role. For anybody who watches the NALCS, Meteos was playing a jungle Nocturne and was able to single-handedly win a game thanks to his, you know, excessive farming and then basically backdooring because there's such good wave pushing power. Oh, that was a little odd. On the side of Selfie. But I'm also interested to see how he deals with Freddy on Aatrox. I believe those will be the two champions looking to split push in these side lanes. And I want to see how the duel plays out because it is something that we don't see from solo lane Nocturnes.
Well, at the moment, Jezzes is the one that's trying to put the pressure down on towards him. Svenskeren spotted out by the pink ward. He does finally notice that he's walking past it. Back in that mid lane.
Just got to give it his
best. I know, right? I know. Mr. Rala and Yero keep trying to force the pressure on towards these mids.
This could be a fight.
AD carry, Selfie looking to engage. You can see coming down, it's going to be Svenskeren. Selfie's going to have to get the support of this one. He's going to try and come in. Teleport comes down. Selfie's trying to hold on, but it's not going to be long enough. And now Svenskeren's in trouble. Myron and Impaler have to turn this one back around. Jezzes can jump in any second. There's the bounce. There he is. Svenskeren gets himself a double. And now Myron's in trouble. He gets slowed down. He should be able to get to the tower and be safe. But it's a double kill for Svenskeren.
Two kills going to Sven. That's actually quite important because Super Hot Crew would not have wanted that on Kassadin. Unfortunately for the Super Hot Crew, no flash on Selfie means he couldn't chase Jezzes. But you'll notice with the item threshold of that Brutalizer and the Bilgewater Cutlass, Selfie won that duel. Selfie was 1v1 against Jezzes and Jezzes needed to flash over the wall to get away. Unfortunately for Super Hot Crew, the support of the rest of SK's team was in greater numbers and it meant they could secure two more kills.
So right now SK Gaming trying to start forcing an advantage, and it's not often that they get the lead in the early game and they move into mid game. We know how strong they are in the late game. Dark Binding on Yero, Unbreakable up at the right time though, blocks out a lot of that damage. Gain. Candy Panda using the ace in the hole the moment it's off cooldown.
Yeah, Mr. Ross tanks up the shot, I believe, because he's got the sustain of the Bloodthirster. So he's going to be able to at least regenerate that health, replenish that health rather on this next minion wave. But what I like about SK as a team is they are the most decisive team when it comes to finishing games. When they do have a lead in Europe, they definitely close the game out more effectively than any other team. Super Hot Crew are just playing full defensive duties. They're waiting for Cataclysm, they're waiting for Paranoia before they look to engage further.
Well, Selfie hasn't come out on top in the last two duels, but that's kind of been down to the fact it's been 2v1s. Did lose that one-on-one in the mid lane. Candy Panda aggressed upon by Mr. Rales. Turns it back around with a bit of damage. Double tap, not landing. Went towards the minion instead. Mimer forced away by Jezzes. Jezzes is starting to grow in power. And this could become a problem for Super Hot Crew. They let this through. They knew the Kassadin was going to get picked up. It's something they've baited it out. Candy Panda caught out. Doesn't get hooked in there. Impaler taking very low here. Svenskeren looking to maybe go across on that one. Flash is not quite available for him just yet. Selfie, meanwhile, off the side, has to perform defensive duties in the top lane.
Yeah, and while Super Hot Crew have been kept busy in the middle, you can see that Freddy was able to push top lane, and Jezz has been able to push the bottom lane. There is good wave clear from Super Hot Crew, though, so they do have defensive capabilities, but they just don't have the numbers. Presence from SK, this is the tower secured.
That's the tower going down. Jezz is spotted out, but it didn't matter. The rest of SK all there in numbers.
Selfie might want to come from behind. He's got Paranoia available. They know Dragon is up, and Superhawker can engage from very big distances. The combo of Jarvan plus the combo of Nocturne is quite scary, but they're going to be there too late.
Yeah, they're trading. You can see they're already pinging onto the tower, saying we'll take the tower instead. Straight on itself, he simply face tanks that one. They know the dragon's going to go down. It's SK that secure that once again. Third one of the game for them as well. Good control.
4,000 golden lead. More kills, slightly more CS, actually a lot more CS on Sven Skaren. We're going to get back to that in a second. The Super Hot Crew are a little out of position. They do have their backs to the top lane. Freddy may want to jump over this wall. Now, Glacial Fissure is up for Yero. That's going to be how they start the fight, and he's doing it!
Azor in the hole, blocked out. Yellow Star doing the damage straight on towards Candy Pan. He tries to get away. The Fear Leech not quite enough because he got exhausted out by Enraten, who turns around, puts the shackles back down on Selfie. He's out of this fight right now. Sven Skaren comes around. Mr. Rales just trying to put some damage from the side. Freddy trying to catch on towards him. Oh, the stun not quite landing through. And now he's going to try and catch on towards it. Jessen taking slow though. He gets stunned out. Vayner goes in. Super Hot Crew turned his fight just back around. Freddy's going to come back out of Bloodwell. He's going to bounce on towards him. Yero takes it so low. Mr. Rallis is going in there. Can he get the ace down? Turns it back around. He's down. And that is the ace. It's a 5-2 to SK Gaming and a triple kill for Candy Panda.
Super Hot Crew got super split in the jungle because all of their forces were on different sides and Jezzers was unable to kill Candy Panda. It just allowed SK's mobility to go in and out. Look at how deep Selfie dives. But because of the Black Shield, the Fear proc is never going to throw Candy Panda away. In the background, you've got a multi-man knockout from Freddy. He keeps Super Hawk Crew splitting. Super Hawk Crew have just taken too much damage. The kill threat that Braum's passive offers was too much. And look at the HP. Average HP in this team fight. It is so much higher for SK. And unfortunately for Super Hawk Crew, they just got pulled too far forward. And Candy Panda just sits in the back line, uses the range of Caitlyn to great effect. A very good team fight for SK Gaming. I think Super Hot Crew, it was a good attempt, but they're a little too far behind.
Candy Panda flashed to get that triple kill at the end. Wanted that last hit. He's like, mine.
Hashtag worth.
Kill secured is another perspective. Mimer, he's going to get in trouble here. Jezzard goes in towards him, feeling much more confident than Cassidy now. And this is a Cassidy that's been unhindered throughout the whole game.
I'd like to point out that Jezzard is building towards a Iceborne Gauntlet. He's got the Sheen collected. It is something that we've seen in North America last week, a full tank Kassadin. He just went full armor, Frozen Heart, Iceborne Gauntlet, Randian's Omen. While he didn't have necessarily the greatest amount of damage, against the melee threats of Lucian, Nocturne, Jarvan, and Lulu's not necessarily the highest burst damage mage, that is such a smart item choice. It allows you to kite, it allows you to control the Super Hot Crew, get those slows down, and also if Jezzers jumps into a team fight, he's not going to get instantly melted by all of this attack damage itemization from the Super Hot Crew.
So far, SK Gaming looking solid. Impaler takes another ace in the hole. The second it's on cooldown, he's generally using that one out there. Sven Skaren clearing out this ward. It didn't quite get vision of that one. Freddy off the side, he's split pushing down that bot lane. You can see Jez is in the top lane, he's pushing in. Selfie is keeping them at bay, and they're gonna see Mima trying to do the same from Freddy. A 1-3-1 push from SK Gaming here.
And SK are arguably the best split pushers in the league at this point in time. I think they play the map very, very well, and it's the reason that they can finish games so effectively. We're at 22 minutes. Freddy and Sven Skaren got positioning on the inner turret. They've got backup from the rest of the team, and Mima's in trouble.
They're going on to Mima. He's already used his Wild Growth. He's got no escape now. He's going to try and use the speed. Can he get away from this one? He does just about crawl out of there.
He does
get himself away. It will be the tower going down. No support from Super Hot Crew.
Contrast how SK Gaming forced the objective and Jezzers is getting jumped on.
Impaler's coming around on towards him. Paranoid goes in there. He's going to try and turn this one back around. Cataclysm may well lock them both in there. Jezzers tries to slide away from this one. Impaler, he needs to get his dragon flag. Get back in there. No, can't catch Jezzers.
Nah, I don't think so. Jezzers will get away. But the point that I was getting to a moment ago, look at how effectively SK Gaming forced that inner turret. They managed to pull Super Hot Crew all across the map by the 1-3-1 push. The moment an opportunity presented in the bottom lane, they went for it. Sven Skaren dove, he went around the back line, and they got the tower secured. So SK Gaming have got one outer turret still standing to secure, which is in the top lane. And I do think it's going to be the next point of focus for the team. Get some vision in Super Hot Crew's red side jungle. I mean, look at Candy Pan. He's got himself a chain vest as his next item because of how much physical damage Super Hot Crew have. It is fairly easy to itemize against a team that is mostly AD damage.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong. Why would you open with Paranoia if he's literally the only man walking in the 2v1 situation?
So it wasn't that he opened with it, he'd already been dueling, and the Rift Walk from Jezzes had already been used. So after the Rift Walk, Selfie then followed with Paranoia, and Impaler was coming from Skybrush. So it's the only way that Impaler can stick
well,
to him.
Give him the benefit of the doubt. I'm not sure on that one myself.
He'd already used the Blade of the Rune King as well earlier on, so he's trying to stick to him. But unfortunately, it's so difficult to stick to Kasten. He needed Impaler there sooner to try get that Martial Cadence like burst damage down from Jarvan's passive, and it didn't happen at the time.
It was not enough, that's for sure. Freddy, a Selfie with him this time. Let's see if Selfie fancies this one. He's got backup of Impaler. Cataclysm is available any second now. Freddy is just going to back away from this one. Slide straight in. Freddy already backs away. Now he's got the support of the rest of his team. Four members moving around, but they're going to look to shut off. Yarrow coming in the side there. They have good vision. Does get caught out. The Unbreakable goes down, but it's not enough to stop the damage from SK Gaming. Svenskeren snuck around the side of that shield.
Killed before he can even animate his ulti. Now they pick the fight with Freddy.
2v1. Freddy wants this one, that's for sure. He's going for Impaler. Impaler Cataclysm's in. That's not what you want to do. Run away, man. It's Brit versus Brit, and Freddy is coming out and topping a 2v1. Now Svenskeren's going to join him. He's got backup of Scandinavia to help him out on this one. Poland is not working out too well for Selfie right now. He may well get on towards him. Mima's coming around. The Bloodwell has been popped. Where are you going to go, though? Selfie is running away. He's got no one to help him out, and Svenskeren is tracking.
And Selfie's got no mana to play with either. It does look like Super Crew have just been pulled too thin. Selfie should go down.
Selfie pops that ultimate on towards him. He should get the slow. Selfie trying to get the speed boost, but look at this. Jezzes is closing ground. They're actually taking the dragon down while this all happens. Svenskeren quite happily dueling. And that's a jungler taking down a mid laner.
And that's just not a good position for Super Hot Crew. They're so far behind in terms of gold, and they're just not on the same page. Mima and Selfie didn't want to pick a fight with Freddy because they were afraid of if SK was going to respond. The reason they didn't shut him down and just engage in that little narrow opening in the forest is because of the fact SK were grouped in middle. Anyways, SK grabs themselves another dragon. Super Hot Crew further behind in
where
gold.
Are they going?
And now Super Hot Crew may lose an inhibitor turret because nobody's home.
Defend your base, guys. That's what you've got to do. SK Gaming in four members pushing in, taking the inhibitor for free. Nobody reacting. We see Yarrow and Mr. Rala slowly making their way back behind SK Gaming again. They're going to try and collapse around him, but I'm not sure this is the play they want to make. Glacial Fissure lands on towards Svenskeren. They're going to lock him up. He will go down. But question is, can they make anything else from this one? Selfie, Wild Growth has to be used. Candy Panda casts on towards him. He takes it down. Yarrow's in trouble. He gets picked up as well. Jess is on towards it. This could be SK Gaming closing the game out right here. Impaler's going to get focused out. He tries to slide in, but he's got five members of SK Gaming all over him. Candy Panda gets himself a second. And it's a 3-0 with an exposed base.
There's a minion wave coming up behind him, and there is wave clear from Lulu and Lucian, so they're going to back away. London is calling, and Freddy is answering. He is in Super Hot Crew's face, landing so many knockups time and time and time again. And the Super Hot Crew, their early game strength of Jarvan and Nocturne is just not working out. Look at the focus from Super Hot Crew. Selfie is doing the best he can to force the big threat of Candy Panda away. But unfortunately, he takes so much damage in the process because he's not built anything tanky that he can't stick around once the targets need to get changed. And Freddy stands running amok in the entire Super Hot Crew before they shut down Impaler and actually back away from the push.
13-3, it's clear to say this champion of choice that's going to surprise and amaze everybody was Kassadin.
Good turnaround.
217. SK doing a fantastic job there. Svenskeren went down pretty early on, of course, and we should note, of course, all of the damage early on that did happen. But Jezzes has stuck to his guns, farmed it out, and again, proven that Kassadin cannot be allowed through.
Now, and what I really like about SK is their itemization. You've got a Warmog Zama on Svenskeren in addition to the Randian's Omen.
That's just rude. Yeah.
A little bit. So he's going to be able to survive for an eternity. Candy Panda's got himself a Guardian Angel. So if Selfie ever does catch Candy Panda out of position and without the support of Enrated, he's just going to come back to life. And there's enough damage from Kassadin and Evelyn and Aatrox to actually turn team fights around. So top tower was secured by SK. 12k gold ahead. Candy Panda's just using that ace in the hole for control and for reducing the combat effectiveness of his opponents. Tsubaku don't even want this fight.
No, sooner or later, I'm going to see Stand Behind Me used by Yarrow once he gets that Unbreakable up. One time in this game to actually block those Ace in the Holes. Hasn't used it yet, though. As it stands, SK Gaming, they're pushing around, they're going to rotate along, another inner turret going down, just moving by the numbers in towards the middle, while, well, you can see Super Hot Crew, they have to defend that bottom wave, that's where Selfie's gone, the top wave being cleared out by Mima, while SK just move on with the minions in the mid.
So with the super minions in the bottom lane, SK can also afford to split push again, just control the side lanes and let the minions do the work for them. Once that inhibitor respawns, they could even go back to a 1-3-1 style of push, because Freddy needs multiple members to take him down. Jezzes is so mobile, he can just get away from a ton of fights. And SK completely in control of this area of the map. They got full vision. They're trying to take Baron down. Look at Supaku, they're coming to contest, and Nocturne's not with him. This is 4v5 at best.
Enemy Panda, a little out of position, doesn't matter as Jezzes goes in. It's gonna be Glacial Fissure. Jezzes has actually caught up, taken down, not quite stunned out though. Yero though, just taking a beating. Mima in all sorts of trouble. Svenskeren got so much damage going down. Ace in the hole, not enough to finish them off. SK did peel away. They got themselves in Paler though. That's the jungler down. No smite available, back to Baron.
4v5 and SK just got split apart. They almost got Jezzes down early, but with the minions in the bottom lane pushing closer to the Nexus turret, SK timed their Baron push perfectly. If Super Haku had tried to stall or delay or look for engages, the super minions would have done damage to the Nexus turrets. SK just continued to accelerate their lead, and they show a very good understanding of how to force your opponent's hands and how to create openings and opportunities. Something that we didn't see from the game previously, where Rocket were, you know, very far ahead and just couldn't force their opponents into positions that would work for them.
Well, something we often see from SK Gaming is complete objective control with those all the dragons, all the barons, and 7 towers. 14-3 up in kills, minutes to the next dragon, which almost certainly will be timed down to the split second. They can just move on round. Minions in that bot lane, of course, inhibitor is still there, so it's respawn, they can go back, finish that one off. Jezzes are going to keep that top wave, waiting to see if anyone's going to show themselves first. Doesn't look like it's going to happen for Super Hot Crew. They're not pushing out anymore because simply what they've got no vision.
No, they haven't. And I don't think they made a concerted enough effort in the early game to try and contain Cassidy. Even though Jezzes is very far behind.
Selfie just strolled on in here. Does try to go for this one. I don't think you realize it's just how many members of SK were close by.
Sven manages to smite it away. They weren't looking for the fight because there wasn't enough deep vision for SK. So they didn't look to engage out of fear of being outflanked. But I mean, 317 on this Kassadin, he's got almost completed that Zhonya's Hourglass. Inhibitors respawn in the bottom lane, so let's see how SK opts to take these objectives. They could send Svenskeren, he can flank from
behind. Oh, finding Mr. Morales, that's problems. They're going to try and dive onto this one. Svenskeren coming around the side, he's flanking in there. Remember, there's no tower on the right-hand side. The tower takes a beating. Candy Panda on that one, he's going to take the tower down. Freddy coming into the side there. Selfie taking a lot of punishment as well. And SK just brute force their way into Super Hot Crew's base.
Yeah, they get one. The presence of Svenskeren from the side means Super Hot Crew forced to back away. If they stuck to defend, Sven simply would have thrown his ultimate down and gone for the tower dive. Candy Panda had only the tower in his targets. He didn't look to go for kills. He didn't look to poke Super Q down. And this really is a hell of a turnaround from yesterday, where SK simply couldn't string together a gank, let alone a tower or map-based play.
So Jezzes on a little poke and play with Selfie, who has been basically null and void in this game. 0-5-1 on that Nocturne in the mid lane. We're excited to see it.
Didn't work out. I don't think Impaler was able to make ganks happen. And I think SK did a really good job of accelerating the laning phase. They moved around quickly, they forced towers, and now SK are on their third and final inhibitor turret. Selfie's defending the Nexus, and Supaku are split. They don't have the resources to defend this onslaught from so many directions.
Two flanks, Jake, Gracial, Fissure only catching on towards Enraged. They're going to dive on Candy Panda. Have they got enough in there? Candy Panda, Black Shield, defends him instantly. Impaler goes down. Ace in the hole from Candy Panda, enough to stop him down. Selfie gets caught out by Jezzes. Yarrow in all sorts of trouble. He's going to get locked up. Freddy doing the cleaving damage on towards him. Jezzes gets the kill down. He gets himself the triple. 6-1-8. Cassidy, it's quite clear, is better than Nocturne in the mid lane in this game. SK Gaming, solid performance, 18-3 overall, and that will be them taking themselves second place once again, 8-4 overall in the league. It's a good performance for SK Gaming.
Commanding victory from the absolute get-go. SK Gaming just had a very good plan. They got a very early dragon. The lane swap from Super Hawk crew or the 4v0 tower pushers didn't really gain anybody a big advantage. And I just feel that more effort needed to be placed on getting Selfie rolling. He was reliant on his own presence, his own farming, and had very little gank support from Impaler. So, I don't know, props for trying, but it just didn't work out.
Yeah, you often wonder with these little unique champions that they try out there. If they work, they look like genius. If they backfire, it looks horrendous. And if your gamble is to let a Kassadin through on a player that you know will play Kassadin, which is clearly what they were aiming at, this was clearly the tactic all along, you've got to wonder just how much they weigh up their options. Clearly, it was a high-risk, high-reward payout that just backfired.
I completely agree. Had that Nocturne been able to actually dive onto champions and kill them, it would have been a lot more effective. But you've seen how effective the Black Shield was from Morgana. Every time Candy Painter got jumped onto, Black Shield was there, which just meant the Fear proc from Nocturne wasn't available. And because Selfie never got ahead, he never had the damage to kill anybody. So it just didn't work out for him at all.
Well, fantastic performance overall. SK Gaming, of course, they went down to Alliance. It was a dominant performance by Alliance. They're chasing them still. Second place, got themselves clear once again. They're clearly looking like one of the top two teams in Europe right now, no doubt about that.
If you look at the European region as a whole, SK and Alliance are clearly head and shoulders above the remainder of the teams. Then you've got this sort of scrap in the middle lane, and then two or three teams arguably fighting at the bottom of the table. But SK Gaming need to ensure that they can consistently play at this level, because Alliance seem to be showing them up in terms of consistency when you consider Alliance were inconsistent in the spring split.
Inconsistent, that's for sure. Shox is standing by on stage with Candy Panda, so let's send it over to her.
Thank you very much, D-Man. Well, if there's someone that's consistent, it certainly is Candy Panda, always putting up good numbers. Congratulations, Candy Panda. A victory here for SK Gaming. And an applause from the crowd, of course, as it suits. Tell me about coming into this game after yesterday, because it wasn't the best day for you guys. So what did you work on coming into this one?
Yeah, so yesterday we didn't prepare well enough. So today we really put effort into preparing a good team strategy, and we pulled it out.
So tell me then, of course, something not foreseen coming in here with the Nocturne pick. How much did you know that it was coming or not at all, and how did you play against it?
So we heard some rumors that they might have practiced Nocturne, but so we were scared to pick the Kassadin. But in the end, we said we are confident in our Kassadin and our playstyle. We also had the Morgana and the Caitlyn who can escape from the Nocturne really easily. So we were confident, and then we just picked it. And yeah, it was a surprise, but it didn't work out for them.
Yeah, absolutely. Then tell me about playing here on this stage. You are, of course, you've been around since season one. You've seen a lot of stages, but I don't think you ever get used to this.
Yeah, even after 3 years, this is like the biggest stage I've ever been to, and London is really awesome. Like, the crowd is just awesome, so, yeah.
And the crowd here, absolutely great. They've been supporting you, of course, throughout the seasons as well. So, as the caster said, you guys and Alliance top two right now in Europe, but lacking a little consistency for you guys. So, how do you think it's going to go for the rest of the season?
We kind of forgot how to play the game in the middle of the, like, between the splits. We had the break and we just lost our flow. So, that's why we're a little bit inconsistent, but we pick it up again and we learn again and again. And then we're going to be good at the end of the season.
All right, we'll see what's in store. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Well, that was some nice words from Candy Panda. Now for some nice words at the analyst desk with the Fishy Joe.
Thank you very much, Shox. And as they rightly pointed out, SK Gaming back onto winning form and really, really strong play out of them as well. Want to start with the picks and bans and this whole Nocturne pick, leaving Kassadin open, taking the Nocturne into it. What do you reckon to that?
Well, so Ken Penn actually just said himself that he heard a rumor about his Nocturne mid here. And they actually built a comp pretty much to counter it. Already from first pick in Morgana into going Caitlyn. Why, an AD carry with Candy Penn hasn't played for a while. However, it's an AD carry with a jump. How do you survive Nocturne jumping you? You need to have something to jump away from him. It works perfectly. You get the Black Shield, you won't get feared. And therefore, Caitlyn won't die to the Nocturne dive in, which was the whole idea for Subaru. So I have to question the fact they actually didn't realize this one during the picks and bans Subaru, because we saw Morgana first into Evelynn and Caitlyn. It's where in my mind Subaru to say, okay, clearly they have built a combo already which is very strong against Nocturne and Jarvan in the case, and say, okay, we're not going to play these champions. I mean, Elise was open, could have gone Elise jungle. could also said, okay, we can just pick a Kassadin ourselves. Instead, they let Kassadin go through even further and were so tunnel vision on this Nocturne pick here, they didn't even realize SK had already built a comp to counter it.
Well, we actually have a replay of some amazing action that came into First Blood, and Yarrow actually showing that he is definitely a top-notch support.
Yeah, so let's just pull it up on the screen here. The thing is, Yarrow, for me, has been very, very good this week. And this First Blood, we were actually watching it backstage here and thinking, what's going to happen here? He's very, very low. Sven's going to spin here for a while. But this time around, Subaru have full vision, or like, they know exactly, full knowledge of what's about to happen here. Let's just roll the clip. Notice how both summoners are ready for Yarrow and his ulti. So he's just waiting for Svenskan to show himself. As soon as Svenskan shows, puts up the E, lands everything onto him, locks him down, and now he's getting stunned under the tower here. Exhaust reduced, flash reduced. Yarrow's not even close to going down. Meanwhile, in the mid lane here, first sign of big, big issues. Nocturne is supposed to be the counter here to Kassadin in lane. You definitely don't want to give up a kill one-on-one. I do think Selfie was looking to the bot lane and actually moving down already, while Jesus then jumps him, gets some damage onto him before Selfie realizes and then can try and fight back.
And the fact is that SK, once they got rolling in this game, they didn't really slow down either. It was a bit of a whitewash in terms of kills.
So it's the thing we always know about SK Gaming. Once they pick the lead, or once they get the lead, they know how to close it out. And we actually see Subaru being aggressive once again, but SK Gaming just know exactly what's about to happen. So let's pull up the second replay. Big, big team fight around the 19-20 minute mark here. And this is similarly SK Gaming showing their comp and how good it is against this Nocturne. So if we just roll the clip here, all focus, of course, from Selfie is on to Candy Panda and his Caitlyn here. But Enraged just sticks together with him. We just see the clip starting here. Yarrow engages first. It's actually a pretty good engage. Selfie comes in. Black Shield instantly from Enraged. Ulti coming in as well from Enraged here. Selfie at this point, there's nothing he can do to take him down, so he's dead. And now the rest of the fight, while Subaru actually managed to disengage, they've lost the kill pressure from having Selfie ulti in. And even though they get a very good stun and CC on to Jesse here and actually managed to kill him, they're still so low from this fight, and Candy Panda is in the backside here, and Freddy, of course, respawning, can just finish off the targets, get the ace for SK Gaming, and they just used the comp against this Nocturne really well and completely shot down the pick.
Was that the whole problem, do you think, for the Super Hot Crew, that the comp that they went for, that they'd obviously been practicing here, just was outpicked by SK?
So it was outpicked, and I don't feel they played aggressive enough early on in the mid lane with Selfie. Like, they needed Impaler came in a few times to try and gank, but for some reason they never actually spotted out the ward, so they never expected the side he was coming to be warded. So he always just stood there, SK had full vision of him, and it was just a massive issue for them. And overall, once your counterpick in mid lane doesn't actually really work out, and you don't get anything from it early, it's just a big issue, especially coming into team fights.
Well, fantastic win there for SK Gaming, guys. We need to take a quick break, but when we come back, it's Fnatic versus Millennium, so stay tuned.
We are Nocturne.
I can't get him.
Okay, look, flash.
Go.
We got Kassadin.
Yeah.
Kill Jabba.
I'm in passive.
We can turn this.
Kill them all.
Nice!
Go!
Oh. Nice!
Good job.
Good job.